opening song this morning, Jesus, Jesus, Oh What a Wonderful Child, we'll sing it through three times. It's too short to just do it once.
Thank you very much, Steve, for that beautiful song. It reminds me so very much of the small choir that I used to sing with in my home congregation. We welcome you to this live streamed service of worship at the Sojourners United Church of Christ. We welcome those of you who are regular attendees and those who may be new and worshiping with us for the very first time. We are blessed today to have sharing in our worship as liturgist, Reverend Pat Barth. The time with children will be provided by Kathy Dobie, our Director of Faith Formation. And of course, the voice you've already heard, Steve Little, is with us as vocalist and pianist. We're also blessed today with the technical connections that are being not only set up, but monitored by Ian Little and Reverend Karen Mann. We welcome you to this service. There will be others participating as well when we come to the time for the lighting of the Advent candles and other sections of this service. Pray for us that God will bless us in this time of worship together. And now for our call to worship, we present to you Reverend Pat Barth.
Rejoice, the Spirit of God is sending us.
To bring good news to the oppressed, to comfort the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to proclaim the year of favor among God's people.
Rejoice. The work of the Spirit is calling us.
To rebuild ancient relationships ruined by injustice, to repair the cities as places of hope, to restore land devastated across generations, to proclaim the year of favor among God's people.
Rejoice. The glory of the Spirit is leading us.
To cast off in a faint spirit and put on the mantle of praise, to take root as the plantings of the Holy One, to display God's glory.
Come, let us worship in joy.
While keeping your devices muted, let us join in the invocation. Holy One, builder who delights in making spaces of safety and beauty, matchmaker who rejoices in presenting new spouses with a future of hope, fill us today with the gifts we need to join you in your life-sustaining, hope-giving work in the world. Let us share your joyful vision of beauty and justice in the world you have created and loved. In the name of the one who is coming, amen. Sojourners, we have been blessed for the past two Sundays with the first and the second stanzas of the song, I Believe, an arrangement by Mark A. Miller with lyrics by Gordon Light. Today we'll be blessed with the third stanza of that hymn sung by Erin Wallace. And now for the lighting of our Advent candles, the candle of joy on this day, Enid Krieger and Marie Baker.
We begin today with scripture, a passage from 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 to 24. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit. Do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil.
May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. And may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this.
Dear God, we light this third candle and delight in the sparkle of its outrageous reminder to rejoice. Let its flames cast light into shadowy places and show where work is to be done. Let a community of builders be formed in the light of joy.
Let joy find home in your hearts and make space for your presence there as we work for justice and peace in the service of love. God be with us in this light of joy.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Enid and Marie.
This is the time that the children usually collect donations, excuse me, donations of food for the food bank from the congregation. The food bank and other organizations still need your donations, perhaps even more now than previously. It may be easier right now to contribute financially to the Blue Ridge Area Food Bank. Thank you.
Today, we light the joy candle on our Advent wreath. Joy, that word shows up in our readings today. There's a difference between joy and happiness. Happiness can happen here or there. You get your favorite food for supper. There's a 2-hour school delay. But joy is deeper. It's what's important to you and can't be taken away. Joy is knowing that your parents love you and will take care of you always. Joy is knowing that you love your parents and you will do all sorts of things to show your love to them. Joy is knowing that God is in charge of the world and is taking care of it, even when things look like they might be going wrong at the moment. Some of you may not know this, but joy is my favorite word. And over the years, friends have brought me things with joy. I have joy ornaments. I have joy mugs. Joy candlesticks. Joy plates. And pillows. And even at one time, I had a license plate that said, "Choose joy." But the interesting thing is when joy became my favorite word. It was actually during the most difficult and challenging time in my life. I had gotten really sick, and the doctor said, "You have to go into surgery really quick." And everyone around me was worried and they were afraid. But you know, I had this deep peace that I was not alone. And it was a long recovery, but the word joy stuck. There were lots of things outside of me and around me that were challenging. And I could choose on those hard days to remember that I had reasons for joy. And I began to take delight in the simplest of things: being alive, having a good cup of coffee, the first signs of spring, crocuses coming up in a New England winter, and hearing the laughter of children. It wasn't a fake pretend thing, but it was holding on to the hard and the good. In the midst of the suffering, there was still capacity for joy. You know, and I'm wondering, as we prepare for Christmas, how can we choose joy? It's easy to feel and act a little crabby when we can't do the things like we did of Christmas past. We can't go to the theater or movies or concerts. We might can't travel to visit family or go over to friends' houses and see what they got for Christmas. But maybe this year we find new ways of connecting and finding joy. Different, but not less. So this week I encourage you to remember all the reasons that you have for joy. When you are out and about, I invite you in your car to play the Christmas carol, "Joy to the World." Crank it up and think about how you can choose joy, how you can act joyfully. Look for and pay attention to God's goodness right where you are. Thanks, my friends. I hope you have a great week. And now Pat Barth will lead us in our contemporary reading.
Our first reading comes from Brennan Manning, a 21st century writer. Everybody has a vocation to some form of life work. However, behind that call, and deeper than any call, everybody has a vocation to be a person, to be fully and deeply human in Christ Jesus. Oscar Romero, 20th century. Let us not forget, we are a pilgrim church, subject to misunderstanding, to persecution, but a church that walks serene because it bears the force of love. Our scripture reading comes from the Gospel according to John, chapter 1. There was a man sent from God whose name was God. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" John confessed, and he did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water." Excuse me. "Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me, and I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany, across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Reverend Both. I would like to repeat one sentence of that scripture, exciting scripture that you read. And the sentence is this: "Among you stands one whom you do not know." Among you stands one whom you do not know. The year was 2007. The young violinist emerged from the subway train. The metro in the city of Washington, D.C. When he exited into the LaFont Plaza station, positioned himself against a wall near a garbage can. He was nondescript, perhaps, in his appearance, and he really was. Youngish white male, dressed in blue jeans, a long sleeve t-shirt, and a baseball cap. From a small case, he removed a violin, placing the open case at his feet. And he threw in a few coins and a couple of dollar bills. We would call those seed money. And then he turned in a direction to face the pedestrian traffic as people were getting off the subway at LaFont Plaza. And he began to play. In the middle of the morning rush hour, the violinist performed six great classical pieces, more than 1,000 people passed by during the time he was playing. Almost all of them sort of fit the description of being mid-level bureaucrats on their way to work. Each passerby had a choice to make, sojourners, a choice familiar to commuters in nearly every urban area, and many of us in smaller towns. Stop and listen, or to hurry past with the blend of guilt and irritation. Among them stood one whom they did not know. What would be our choice? Throw a little change in the basket politely? What if he's really good at what he's doing? Do you have time for beauty, for goodness? There is a certain president whose name I will not call, who essentially said to a tech employee, a government employee, what, you protected the election of the United States? How dare you do a good thing? Get out of here. You're fired. Do we have time for folk who are gonna do the right thing, introduce beauty? None of the commuters knew that the violinist was one of the world's leading classical musicians, Joshua Bell. Bell is an acclaimed virtuoso who filled the house of Boston's Symphony Hall just 3 days earlier, where some seats sold for more than $100. One composer said of him, quote, he plays like a god, small g, end of quote. And on this Friday morning, he was playing the instrument of the gods, again, small g, a $3.5 million Stradivarius. But he was playing it like an ordinary street musician there in Washington, D.C. The acoustics in that subway station, and I've been there many times, and so have many of you, helped to make the music even more beautiful as the sounds bounced off of the curves in that subway station. So what do you think happened, sojourners? This entire episode was an experiment arranged by the Washington Post. A reporter recorded the event. In the first 3 minutes, more than 60 people walked past without noticing. Joshua Bell played for a total of 45 minutes. During that time, and hear these numbers, 7 people stopped to listen at least for 1 minute. 27 people gave money, some of them small coins. But for the most part, Joshua Bell was ignored in the rush hour busyness of Washington, D.C. A woman named Stacy, only her first name was given, recognized him because she had attended a concert of Bill's 3 weeks earlier. And these are her words. And there he was. Excitedly, she spoke. The international virtuoso playing away, begging for money. She had no idea what was going on, but she stayed until the end. And so Stacy told the reporter, quote, "It was the most astonishing thing I have ever seen in Washington, D.C. Joshua Bell was standing there playing in rush hour, and people were not stopping, not even looking. And some were flipping quarters at him." And then she said it again for emphasis, quarters. And then she asked the question, preceded by this expression, "Oh my gosh, what kind of city do I live in? A city where this could happen." Well, Stacy, maybe it could have happened in any of the cities we live in, and it could have happened in Bethlehem in a similar event around 2,000 years ago. God did another amazing thing in the presence of commuters, just like the Washington Post did. God staged a symphony in Bethlehem. The music was heavenly, almost like angels singing. But except for the attention of a few smelly shepherds out in the field, it sort of slipped by unnoticed. Because really, who would have expected anything special to happen in a rural blue-collar neighborhood far from the center of the Roman Empire? Who could imagine that a child of any importance could have such a noble birth, placed in a trough, a feeding trough? I noticed that word manger is the same word used in the French language for something to eat, manger. Who would have thought that any child of importance would enter the world in such a way? The Washington Post draws this conclusion about its experiment with Joshua Bell. Quote, "Life is out of balance," they said. "We have the wrong priorities. We can't take the time out of our lives to stay a moment and listen to one of the best musicians on earth as he plays some of the best music ever written. If the surge of a modern day life so overpowers us that we are deaf and blind to something like that, then what else, they ask, are we missing? What else, sojourners? As we approach a celebration of the birth of Christ, what else are we missing? I think we may draw that same conclusion about the Christmas story. In the midst of the dogged busyness of lives, God is playing for us a tune full of love and passion, glory and salvation. And some folk don't even want to use the word salvation. We are so very brilliant. We don't want to use words like that. Grace and mercy. And God is pleading with us to simply notice. As the wonderful line in the hymn, "It Came Upon the Midnight Clear," states it. I'm going to share four lines. "And yet beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. Oh, rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing." But sojourners, on this third Sunday of Advent, I would like the sermon not simply to be about rush hour traffic in Washington, D.C. I want it to be about God, who would engineer this scenario. The God who sneaks into the world, not with drones, not with ballistic missiles, but a God who would enter the world as a child. And so I'm drawn to what Luke's gospel says about the Christmas story and what it says about God. What is that all about? There is this deep theological, political meaning behind a story that claims the attention of adults as well as children. It begins with the powerful, the political kingmakers, let's call them, of the empire. The ones who can command that the little people take time off work, probably without pay, make a long journey into Bethlehem, undertaking an expensive journey so they can do what? Pay their taxes. Luke was aware of the scandalous nature of the story. His context is a despair of a people oppressed by a brutal empire. Luke's Holy Family are just a couple of nameless, dispensable passengers who are on the journey, shoved around by the powers that be. And with them in this telling, Luke is creating a shadow story, a challenge to the empire that is both clever and daring. That well-known expression, "Glory to God in the highest," I sometimes forget that that was the phrase used by Romans to refer to Caesar. Glory to God in the highest. You don't need to be in the court of Caesar, though, according to Luke, to encounter God with the capital G. You can be kneeling in a stable, kneeling on the straw, perhaps smelling the droppings that are there in the stable. You can receive the good news, sojourners, that the illness you heard about weeks ago is one that requires chemo, but God is there with you also. You may receive the news that that relationship that was budding and growing has now come to an end, but God is there with you also. You may be unable to be present with that relative who is suffering because of COVID-19. But even in the painful journey that that requires of us, we may know that God is there also. My sense is, if God could be present with a family whose income level would have qualified them for food stamps, don't you know that God can be present with us? That means two things to me, and I'll say them rather quickly. First, the birth of Jesus is a sign of an attentive, I'm so sorry, a sign of an alternative world, a realm where a vulnerable child is cherished, where shepherds and the short order cooks at Burger King and McDonald's and the elderly who work at Walmart because they can't live on their retirement incomes. An alternate world is getting a special divine message delivered to them. It is a message where peace comes to people, all of whom are favored by the God who created them. And because this story is set in such ordinary circumstances, it invites us to enter the story, sojourners, and to take part in the story. We belong in the story, but we must decide which role we're going to play. And finally, this Christmas story means that Jesus, who is born in less than ideal circumstances and conditions, can be born over and over again in oppressive circumstances and conditions. In the sadness, in the bereavement, in the isolation and loneliness of a pandemic, God is there in our less than ideal circumstances and conditions. I find it wonderful that God became flesh and was first presented to us in a manger, an unexpected place, to say the least. Stop, sojourners. Listen for the glorious music in the clutter of the subways of life. And oh, rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing. In the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us look to God in prayer. Dear God, we acknowledge that at times we have been too busy to notice you. Even when you have spoken to us, walked beside us, and held us up in your arms, even then, we didn't know who you were. Come quickly, dear God, and bless us, that we may stop, look, and listen to your still speaking voice. Grant to us discerning spirits that we may clearly sense your presence at all times and live our lives in ways that bring honor and glory to your name. Amen. Sojourners, we have reached that point in our service where we make an appeal for an offering. As indicated a couple of weeks ago, we're getting very close to the end of the year, and we urge you to consider whether your pledges have been met, and if not, we want to urge you to meet those pledges, both in struggle and in joy. God is faithful to us. We bring forth our offerings to demonstrate our faithfulness to God. We invite you to look on the Sojourners website, those of you who are using your electrical devices, digital devices, and find the donate button, and there you can make your contribution. Those of you who are still considering your pledges for 2021, you may also do that, make your pledge on the Sojourners website. Because we are confident that you will do whatever you are able to do, let us give God thanks for the gifts that shall be made. Faithful God, accept these gifts of our hearts and hands. May they be multiplied and magnified as the living presence of Christ in the world. Amen. And now for our joys and concerns, we present to you Reverend Karen Mann.
Good morning, Sojourners. What a joyful day to be with you. As we prepare for our time of prayer, I ask that you submit your joys or concerns either in the comment section on Facebook, remembering that that is the public forum, or in the chat box on Zoom. And while we give you a chance to write those, we would ask Steve to please play some music for us. Steve? Right. Pat Bart offers this prayer. Nathaniel Howell, former ambassador to Kuwait, has entered hospice care. Please pray for his family. Pat, we pray with you and with him and his family. Donna Wiley gives thanksgiving for Cindy's successful surgery and good pathology report. Thanks to all who have been praying. Donna will say amen to that, and we continue to pray with you and her. Kate Galloway asks prayers for her cousin and her spouse who have COVID. Kate, we pray with you. Jean Baker offers prayers for my friend having relationship troubles. Jean, we pray with you and with your friend. Janine Biber says, please lift up my sister Janet, who has been diagnosed with breast cancer. Janine, we pray with you. Just giving a minute to see if anybody else is typing. Julie Clark says, a joyful prayer. Kendall Stewart, our nursery caregiver, is engaged to be married. Her fiance proposed her on air on the radio station. She is very happy. Well, we give thanks for that. A big amen. And Kendall, if you ever listen to this, congratulations to you. We're so happy for you. Pastor Morgan offers prayers for all who received the vaccine this week. Amen, and we pray with you, and a joy that there is a vaccine that is beginning to be rolled out. We give thanks for that. Amen. Ben Smith says, asking prayers for Stefan as he takes the GRE test this week for entrance to MBA programs. Ben, Stefan, we pray with you. Enid Krieger offers prayers of thanksgiving for Bev Sang's health after a scare this past week. Enid and Bev, we pray with you and give joy that things are better. And that is all that I see at this time. If I have missed you somehow, know that we hold you in our hearts in prayer. And I ask Pastor Morgan to please pray for us aloud now.
Thank you very much, Karen. And we thank all of you for sharing your concerns. Among those concerns are wonderful joys, which bring smiles to our faces. And of course, there is sad news as well regarding illness, even the possibility of pending hospice care, and for others, pending death. Let us look to God in prayer. Eternal God, there are moments when we reach the point where we sense there is nothing more we can do. There are moments that cause us to throw up our hands in despair, sensing that all is lost. But it is in those moments we have noticed that you are most likely to reveal yourself to us in ways that are so clear and discernible that we do not miss your presence. Forgive us, dear God, for bypassing you on the streets of our cities. We did not know 'twas you. Guide us, dear God, and grant us greater clarity of vision, greater degrees of empathy, greater degrees of concern and compassion for others, that we may not miss you during this season of giving and in the years and months that follow. Be with us, dear God, simply that we may be the body of Christ, ministering to people in all walks of life, and especially those who are suffering the most. Guide us. We thank you for speaking to us through the scriptures, through your word. We thank you even when we question whether the words are your words or the words of men. We know we are so inclined to add stuff to the things we are writing, but we thank you, dear God, for the inspiration, because it is in the reading of these words that we are inspired so very much to do your will. This prayer we offer in your many names. Amen. We thank you so much for being present with us today. Pray for all who are engaged in the ministries of Sojourners. We're not referring to staff only, of course, all who are part of this beautiful community of faith, as we look forward now to the celebrating of the birth of the Christ child. Let joy ring forth in all of our hearts, one toward the other. I really appreciated that story that Kathy shared. What a beautiful word to latch on to, joy. And what a difference it can make in our lives. Thank you for your presence. And now let us hear a call of resistance as we depart. Steve Brinkley will be coming.
Thank you, Pastor Morgan. And just a few words about our final selection, which, as Pastor Morgan noted, is a carol of resistance. Many are aware, of course, that the tune is from Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, and I'm a big fan of Beethoven. I guess that shouldn't be a surprise, but it has been an inspiration to many in the resistance movements throughout history. And in fact, we're going to be talking about that Friday night at 7, so I invite you to join us as we go into more detail about the Hymn to Joy and its impact on resistance movements. The night was at Tiananmen Square in the spring of 1989 during the student revolt. The same year when the Berlin Wall came down, the Ninth was there to amplify the celebrations. Under the Pinochet dictatorship in Chile, women marched on torture prisons with the Ode to Joy as inspiration. And in Japan, the Ninth was there to repair and heal after the devastating tsunami of 2011.
Joyful, joyful, we adore you, God of glory, God of love. Hearts unfold like clouds before you, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the storms of doubt away.
Thank you very much, Steve. We appreciate that very, very much. We thank you for being with us today in this service of worship. Let us now receive this brief benediction. Go forth confident that God is faithful. Those who have sowed in sorrow will return with shouts of joy, bearing the harvest of God's work. Rejoice always. The Lord is near. Amen.